Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Vanderbeekers and the Hidden Garden by Karina Young Glaser. Narrated by Robin Miles. Tuesday, June 26th. Chapter 1.
This is the most boring summer in the whole history of the world,
9-year-old Oliver Vanderbeeker announced. He was wearing basketball shorts and a faded blue t-shirt, and his hair was sticking out in every direction.
It's only the first week of summer vacation,
Miss Josie, the Vanderbeeker's second-floor neighbor, pointed out. The Vanderbeekers, who lived on the ground floor and first floor of a brownstone in Harlem, spent a lot of time on the second floor when their mother was busy baking for her clients. Miss Josie had her hair in curlers and was watering her many trays of seedlings, which covered the dining room table. When she was finished, she stepped over to a window box, clipped a few small purple flowers, and put them in a bud vase before handing it to Laney.
Bring these to Mr. Jeet, won't you, dear?
Laney, 5 1/4 years old and the youngest of Oliver's 4 sisters, stopped tying ribbons around the ears of her rabbit, Paganini, and stood up. She wore a silver skirt made of sparkly tulle, a purple t-shirt, and sparkly red shoes. The shoes were slippery on the bottom, so she shuffled slowly over to Mr. Jeet, careful not to spill the water in the vase. Paganini hopped close by her heels, shaking his head, causing his ears to flip around and the ribbons to launch in different directions.
How are you both already?
Mr. Biederman asked. Mr. Biederman was their third-floor neighbor and landlord, and up until half a year ago, he hadn't left his apartment in 6 years. He had almost refused to renew their lease back in December, but the Vanderbeeker kids had managed to convince him to let them stay, and now they were working on getting him outside the brownstone. He visited the Vanderbeekers, as well as Miss Josie and her husband Mr. Jeet, almost daily, but he had never left the building once in all that time. Oliver slumped into a sunshine yellow vinyl chair at the kitchen table, his elbows on the metal tabletop, his hands propping up his head.
There's nothing to do. Nothing I can do, anyways.
Oliver watched Miss Josie pull a shoebox down from a high cupboard and lift the top off. Inside were a dozen pill bottles. One by one, she opened the bottles and shook pills into a cup.
And what do you want to do?
She asked.
Text my friends, Oliver said immediately. Watch basketball videos on YouTube. Play Minecraft.
Mr. Biederman flattened his mouth into a straight line.
Kids today,
he muttered, then went back to reading out loud to Mr. Jeet. The book was about the history of roses in England. Oliver noticed that Mr. Jeet's eyes fluttered closed, probably because he was bored to death. Jessie Vanderbeeker, who was a few months away from turning 13, was sitting on Miss Josie's fire escape, reading a biography about the famous physicist Jiansheng Wu. She leaned her head through the kitchen window between a curtain of ivy tendrils trailing down from Mr. Biederman's planters above. Her frizzy hair caught onto some of the ivy, making her look electrocuted.
Oliver, seriously, Jessie said. You're worse than Herman Huxley.
Herman Huxley,
Oliver spluttered. Being compared to Herman Huxley was like being compared to gum on the bottom of your shoe or jellyfish in a lake on a beautiful summer day when all you wanted to do was cannonball off the dock into the water. Herman Huxley complained about everything, including cold weather, hot weather, and his brand new Nikes, which any other kid would sell their most prized possessions for.
Yup,
Jessie said, whipping out her new as-of-last-week phone and punching it with her thumbs. Oliver felt a wave of pure green jealousy wash over him as Jessie flaunted her phone. Jessie continued talking, her eyes never leaving the screen.
You know, Mom and Papa got this for me so I can keep in touch with Isa.
She disappeared back behind the curtain of ivy. Oliver glared in her direction. It wasn't fair. Issa, yet another sister and Jessie's twin, had been chosen for some special 3-week-long orchestra camp 4 hours away by car. But that didn't mean she and Jessie should have whatever they wanted. Hyacinth, age 7, and the sister who annoyed Oliver the least, spoke up from her perch on the armrest of Mr. Jeet's chair, where she was working on a new type of knitting using only her fingers, no needles. By wrapping yarn around her fingers and doing some complicated looping, she created a rope of yarn that fell to the ground. "Tell Issa I love her and miss her a million trillion times. And then put that unicorn emoji at the end and lots of those pink hearts." Next to her was Franz, her basset hound, who sneezed 3 times, then nudged Hyacinth's foot with his nose.
"Ha," said Oliver triumphantly. "She can't even do emojis on that stupid flip phone."
"Language," reminded Miss Josie. She handed Oliver the cup of pills. There were like 100 pills in there, and a glass of water.
"Bring these to Mr. Jeet, will you, dear?"
Oliver unglued himself from his chair and walked to Mr. Jeet. Mr. Jeet wore his customary crisp button-down shirt, a lavender bow tie, and ironed gray slacks. Oliver did not understand why Mr. Jeet voluntarily dressed up every day. He was a jeans and t-shirt guy himself. The dirtier the clothes, the better the mojo. And after he put the pills on the little table by Mr. Jeet's seat, next to a framed photo of the Jeet's 12-year-old grandnephew Orlando posing with a science fair trophy, he dragged himself back to his chair and slumped into it.
"Why don't you play basketball?"
Miss Josie suggested.
"No one's around," he mumbled. "Everyone's at camp, basketball camp."
"Angie isn't at basketball camp,"
Miss Josie said, referring to his next-door neighbor and friend, who was also the best basketball player in their elementary school.
"She's going to summer school in the mornings. Something about an advanced math extra credit course,"
Oliver shuddered.
"I'm sure your mom would love it if you cleaned your room,"
Miss Josie suggested.
"I cleaned it last month,"
Oliver said.
"You could read. Uncle Arthur forgot to bring books the last time he came to visit."
Miss Josie tisked sympathetically. She knew how much Oliver depended on his monthly book delivery from his uncle, who provided him with every story a kid could wish for. Mr. Biederman got up from his chair.
"I've got to check on Princess Cutie. Sometimes she scales the curtains and can't get down."
Princess Cutie was Mr. Biederman's cat, which Hyacinth had given him and Laney had named. Mr. Biederman walked to the door.
"I can teach you how to knit,"
Hyacinth offered her brother, holding her knitted rope in the air.
"If I ever take up knitting, feel free to stab me in the heart,"
Oliver replied.
"You can push me and Paganini on the tire swing,"
Laney suggested, her eyes brightening. Oliver yawned.
"It's too hot."
"Issa would do it,"
Laney grumbled. Miss Josie tapped her chin with a finger.
"Oh, I know.
You're not going to talk about us making that disgusting piece of land next to the church into a garden again, are you?"
Oliver said at the same time, Miss Josie exclaimed,
"You can make that unused land next to the church into a garden."
Miss Josie's recommendation was met with collective boos.
"That place is haunted," Laney said. "Issa said so."
Hyacinth nodded.
"I don't like walking past it."
"Issa said the vines that wrapped around the gate reach out and grab people when they walk by."
"It's not haunted,"
Jessie called out.
"It has never been scientifically proven that ghosts actually exist."
"How do you know?"
Oliver countered.
Have you studied them? Think how nice it would be to have a place to rest in the middle of a hot day.
Miss Josie continued.
People could get into the dirt and even plant vegetables. I'm sure Triple J would approve.
Triple J was the church's pastor.
Do you miss working at the botanical garden, Miss Josie?
Jessie asked, pushing aside the ivy so she could look inside.
Miss Josie had been an educator at the New York Botanical Garden in the Bronx.
I do miss it,
Miss Josie replied.
I worked there for 45 years. That's how I met Mr. Jeet. He was a groundskeeper, and he seemed to show up wherever I was. The rest is history.
She smiled in Mr. Jeet's direction. Mr. Jeet was letting Hyacinth give him one pill at a time. He was slowly swallowing them with water and grimacing after each one. He sure had to take a lot of pills.
If you had a garden, you could plant delicious things for Paganini to eat,
Miss Josie suggested to Laney.
Ooh, he would love that,
Laney replied. Paganini's ears twitched at the sound of his name. Then he jumped into a ceramic pot that held a ficus tree. Miss Josie gently lifted him out before he kicked dirt all over the floor, then set him on Mr. Jeet's lap. Mr. Jeet used his right hand, his left hand still had limited mobility after his stroke 2 years ago, to play with Paganini's ears. His words came out slowly.
You lucky. You cute.
He leaned down while Paganini sat up, and they did a nose bump. Oliver rested his head on the cool metal table. It felt good against his cheek.
A garden sounds like a lot of work.
Herman Huxley, Jessie sang from the window. You are so like him.
Oliver was tired of his sister and her stupid comments and her stupid phone.
Stop saying that. You don't know anything.
Don't be mean to me because you're jealous of my phone, Jessie shot back, climbing through the window.
Okay, kids, Miss Josie interjected. Why don't I put out some tea and cookies?
But Oliver didn't want tea and cookies. He wanted the last word.
Why do you need a phone anyways? It's not like you got into science camp and need to stay in contact with Mom and Papa. Issa's probably off having a great time without you, while you're stuck here all summer doing nothing.
Oliver,
Mr. Jeet called out. Paganini leaped off his lap and onto the carpet, then scurried under an armchair. Mr. Jeet tried to get out of his chair, his face ashen and his arms shaking as he braced himself on the armrests.
Please, Oliver, no fight.
But before he could finish his sentence, his knees buckled and he fell into Hyacinth.
Miss Josie, help,
cried Hyacinth, struggling to support Mr. Jeet's weight.
Jeet,
cried Miss Josie, running toward him. Mr. Biederman burst through the door, just as Mr. Jeet crumpled to the floor. Hyacinth knocked the medicine cup over as she fell into the side table. The pills fell to the floor and scattered in every direction. Chapter 2. The next hour was a blur. Mr. Jeet didn't move, even when Miss Josie shook him and shouted into his ear. Jessie called 911. Oliver ran downstairs to their apartment to get Mama. Mr. Biederman put a blanket over Mr. Jeet's unmoving body, and Jessie couldn't help thinking that it was just like in the movies. Didn't they always put a blanket over dead bodies in movies? Her body felt brittle and bitterly cold, but she made herself go through the motions of helping. She ushered Hyacinth, Laney, Paganini, and Franz into Miss Josie and Mr. Jeet's bedroom. Her sisters threw themselves into her lap and cried into her t-shirt while they waited for the ambulance. Jessie, who was used to letting Issa fill the role of primary comforter, patted her sisters awkwardly on their backs and found herself murmuring, "It'll be okay, and don't worry. The doctors will know how to help him," and other things she didn't know were true. At the sound of the ambulance sirens down the street, she heard Oliver leap down the stairs two at a time, and then the building door bang open. The brownstone groaned under the hurried footsteps of the paramedics.
"Is he dying?"
sobbed Laney, while Paganini settled himself between Mr. Jeet's bedroom slippers.
"Of course not," Jessie said, but she didn't know.
They heard the paramedics rush through the door, then Miss Josie's wobbly voice as she answered questions about Mr. Jeet's age, health, and medicines.
"One, two, three," said a voice.
Jessie disentangled herself from her sisters and opened the bedroom door a crack. The paramedics were lifting Mr. Jeet onto the stretcher. Laney crawled over and peeked out, then burst into fresh tears. Jessie closed the door and leaned against it. She listened to the paramedics talk to each other in low voices as they went down the stairs. Then she heard the brownstone door open and slam shut. There was silence in the apartment. Franz bayed, the deep, mournful sound cutting through the stillness of the room as they listened to the ambulance sirens fade into the distance. Oliver couldn't sleep. His clock read 11:03 p.m. His stomach felt funny, as if a restless octopus had taken up residence there. His brain was filled with the image of Mr. Jeet calling his name, clutching the right side of his body, then falling to the ground. His mom still hadn't come home from the hospital. That was a bad sign, right? His clock clicked again. 11:04 p.m. Mama had called only once to say that the doctors were still doing tests, but that Mr. Jeet was in good hands. Oliver didn't know what was taking so long. Mr. Biederman, Oliver usually shortened his name to Mr. B for efficiency, had brought down Spam sandwiches for dinner around 6 o'clock when their father came home, but Papa and the kids had hardly touched them. Eventually, Mr. B left, accusing the Vanderbeekers of wasting perfectly good food. 11:05 p.m. The brownstone, usually filled with cheerful creaks, was ominously quiet. Oliver wished his bedroom window looked onto the street so he could see if Mama was coming home. Instead, his window looked across at the brownstone next door, where the neighbors kept their shades drawn all the time. 11:06 p.m. Still no sign of Mama. Oliver jumped down from his loft bed and left his room. The kitchen and living areas were downstairs on the ground floor, while all the bedrooms were on the first floor. Lined up, so Jessie and Issa shared the bedroom facing 141st Street. Oliver took a right down the hall and let himself into Jessie's room. His sister was snoring in her typical bulldozer way. He grabbed Issa's desk chair and rolled it to the window. Then he perched on the edge of the chair and rested his elbows on the windowsill, looking for Mama's familiar straight black hair and her purposeful walk. He thought back to when he was little and used to watch out the window for Papa to come home from work. Only Papa's hair was big and unruly, and he walked as if he had all the time in the world. As members of a biracial family, the kids had inherited a surprising blend of physical characteristics from their parents. Although no one looked alike, the twins actually looked the most different from each other. There was a thread of resemblance that connected them and made them all uniquely Vanderbeeker. The street outside was dark and quiet. It was the kind of dark and quiet where bad things could happen. Things like words being said that could never be taken back, or a neighbor dying in a hospital. Oliver sat there so long that the images of the street turned to a blur. A rustle of bed sheets and a happy yelp from the other side of the room startled Oliver so much that the chair rolled out from underneath him and he crashed to the ground, his chin hitting the windowsill on the way down.
Issa!
Jessie ran over to Oliver's crumpled body. Then, oh, she said, realizing her misidentification. Her voice turned flat. It's you.
Don't worry, I'm fine,
Oliver retorted, rubbing his chin. No need to help me up or anything.
Okay,
Jessie said before blinking three times and stumbling back to her bed.
What happened?
Hyacinth asked as she and Laney burst into the room with Franz skidding in behind them.
We heard a crash. Did someone get hurt?
Just me,
Oliver called out from the spot by the window. Laney skipped over.
What hurts? Do you want me to kiss it and make it feel better?
No, Oliver said.
Jessie sat up in her bed. She looked a lot more awake now.
Why is everyone in my room at 11:37 p.m.?
Laney jumped onto Issa's bed and rolled around on the fluffy pillow pile.
I'm not tired, she announced. I've been up for hours. How many dots are on the dice? Why do we call baby cats kittens? What makes a pig's tail curly?
Oliver ignored her.
I'm waiting for Mama. She's not home yet.
Jessie glared at him.
I don't want you guys in here. I'm trying to sleep.
But you have a window,
Oliver protested.
Nope,
Jessie said, grabbing his shoulders and turning him around to face the door. She marched him out into the hallway, then did the same to Hyacinth. Laney was the only one left.
Can I sleep in Issa's bed?
Laney asked, hugging Issa's one stuffed animal, a fuzzy wombat, close to her heart.
Nope, nope, nope,
Jessie replied. She removed the wombat from Laney's arms and threw it back on Issa's bed, picked her sister up, carried her out to the hallway, and deposited her next to Oliver, Hyacinth, and Franz. Then the door closed firmly. Hyacinth looked at Oliver.
Are you sure? Mama's not home yet?
I've been waiting up for her. Papa went to bed an hour ago. I heard him talking to her on the phone. Mr. Ajit is staying in the hospital overnight.
Oliver walked over to the top of the stairs that led down to the ground floor. He sat down on the top step. It had a perfect view of the front door. Laney, Hyacinth, and Franz squeezed onto the step on either side of him, and Oliver was comforted by the company. Tonight was one of those rare nights when he wished he shared a bedroom. He wanted the sounds of someone else in his room.
Will Mr. Jeet be okay?
Hyacinth asked Oliver, leaning into him.
Of course he'll be okay,
Oliver said quickly.
Why wouldn't he?
He looked so sick,
Hyacinth said, putting an arm around Franz and rubbing behind his ear. The door to Jessie's room opened and Jessie came out.
Now I can't sleep, she grumbled.
She nudged Laney's hip with her foot.
Move over.
Chapter 3 Laney snuggled closer to Oliver on the step, and Jessie squeezed in between Laney and the handrail. George Washington emerged from the living room and leaped up the stairs, curling his big cat body at Oliver's feet.
So I've been thinking,
Jessie started at the same time Oliver said, do you think?
You go first,
Jessie and Oliver said in unison. Oliver suddenly felt silly.
It's stupid, just an idea I had.
There's no such thing as a dumb idea.
Hyacinth said the phrase exactly the way Miss Josie did. Oliver rubbed his eyes.
I don't know. I was just thinking about what Miss Josie said earlier. Maybe we should, I don't know, do that thing she suggested.
There was a long silence.
Are you talking about cleaning your room?
Jessie ventured.
No, listen,
Oliver said, his words coming out in a jumble.
A garden. That's what we can do for Miss Josie and Mr. G. Miss Josie never asks for anything, but she's been hinting about that garden for years. And I know Mr. Jeetmas is being outside and seeing his friends. It's the perfect thing for us to have ready for him when he gets back from the hospital.
Oliver didn't mention the fear that lodged itself in his brain, the one that said, if he gets back from the hospital. Oliver waited for his sisters to tell him how brilliant his idea was. Hyacinth's eyes grew round.
I'm not going near that haunted place.
Me neither, Laney commented.
She looked out the darkened windows and shivered.
Plus, there's a sign that says no pass on there. That means if you pass the gate, you'll turn into a gremlin.
Oliver rolled his eyes. I've never seen a sign there. Anyway, you can't even read.
I can too, Laney said. That's what it says.
Jessie spoke up.
That gate is locked up tight. I doubt the church will let us in. Who knows what's inside?
Miss Josie can help us convince them. She's been going to that church for 100 years, Oliver said, undeterred.
100 years,
Hyacinth exclaimed.
He's exaggerating, Jessie told her.
But she has been going there for a long time.
If we start working on it right away, Oliver continued, we can have a big garden extravaganza.
Oliver loved saying the word extravaganza. It was the same word the library used for its annual used book sale, and rolling the word on his tongue never failed to thrill him.
We can do it in a couple of weeks, the day after Issa gets home.
Jessie was still skeptical. That's only 18 days away. Plus, we don't know anything about gardens.
Mama read The Secret Garden to us,
Oliver said.
Gardening doesn't sound so hard. Anyways, you're the science person. A garden is a perfect place to do scientific experimentation, right?
That would be botany, which is not one of my scientific interests,
Jessie pointed out.
Come on, Jessie. Do it for Mr. Jeet and Miss Josie.
Then Oliver played his ace.
Stop acting like Herman Huxley.
Herman Huxley, Jessie exclaimed.
Her voice lowered.
How dare you?
Oliver bit back a smile.
So, are we muskrats or men? Wingbats or women? Ravenclaws or Hufflepuffs? Are we doing this or not?
Jessie sighed.
You know, that did not even make any sense. But fine, I'll do it. But only because I love Miss Josie and Mr. Jeet.
Oliver looked at Hyacinth and Laney, who looked as if they'd rather face Voldemort than venture into the haunted garden.
So we're doing this?
Nope, never. No way, Hyacinth said, burying her face in Franz's neck.
Oliver sighed, then looked at Laney.
Come on, Laney. We'll have so much fun. We can be just like Mary and Dickon and Colin in The Secret Garden. You love that book. And think of a garden full of fresh food for Paganini.
Laney shook her head, her pigtails bouncing across her face.
Paganini doesn't like gremlins either.
It wasn't long before Laney and Hyacinth fell fast asleep, their heads nestled in Jessie's and Oliver's laps. After a long period of silence, Oliver sighed 3 times in a row, glancing at Jessie each time. Jessie looked at him.
What's wrong with you?
Oliver hesitated.
I feel bad about what I said to you today,
he finally said. Jessie was surprised. Her brother rarely apologized for anything.
Oliver grimaced. You know, that thing I said about Issa having a great time this summer without you.
Jessie raised her eyebrows.
Oh, that. Well, I'm sorry, okay? That wasn't very nice of me.
Jessie's mind immediately rewound to April. She remembered sitting around the dinner table while Issa shared the good news about getting accepted to orchestra camp with a full tuition scholarship. She had waved the acceptance letter in the air and bounced excitedly on her feet, actions that were very out of character for reserved Issa. Mama and Papa were quiet as they reviewed the rest of the paperwork, and Jessie remembered glancing at the bill over their shoulders and seeing that the tuition was paid for, but the room and board was not. A week later, Mama had picked up a part-time night job doing some accounting work for the local coffee shop. She looked at Oliver. "I'm sorry I compared you to Herman Huxley." Oliver shrugged.
"It's okay."
They sat in silence for a long time before Mama returned. She looked as exhausted as Jessie had ever seen her. Her clothes were wrinkled, there was a coffee stain on her shirt, and dark circles hung underneath her eyes. Mama glanced up the stairs and smiled wearily at her kids in pajamas all squeezed together on the top step with France and George Washington.
"He's doing fine," Mama said quietly before anyone could say anything.
She made her way up the stairs and kissed each of her kids on the cheek.
"The doctors are doing a lot of tests. Miss Josie is staying with him tonight."
The nurse set up a cot in Mr. Jeet's room for her.
"What happened?"
Oliver whispered. Mama sat on the next stair down beside a purring George Washington.
"He had another stroke."
"Is it affecting his left side again?" Jessie asked.
"Yes. There was a blood clot that led to a vessel in his brain, which is why he got dizzy and fell. He isn't talking yet, but he had medical help right away, so that's really good."
"What caused it?"
Oliver asked. His voice had none of the confident swagger Jessie was used to hearing from her brother.
"Oh, lots of things," Mama said.
He was already at high risk because of his previous stroke. "Once he's out of the hospital, we need to help him get lots of exercise and healthy food, like vegetables and fresh greens. He's a little too fond of Miss Josie's fried chicken. I should probably stop bringing him so many cookies."
Mama did not look pleased about that development. She believed it was her job to supply everyone in the neighborhood with cookies.
"When does he come back home?" Jessie asked.
"The doctor wants Mr. G to have 3 really good days in a row before he'll get released. He'll also need to do physical therapy at the hospital."
Oliver moved Hyacinth's head off his lap and leaned her up against Laney. Jessie watched him get up, edge past Mama and George Washington, and go down the stairs to where a large picture frame hung by the front door. The area inside the frame was painted with chalkboard paint. The Vanderbeekers used it to write reminders and draw pictures. Under the area where Laney had drawn Paganini, Oliver made a chart. When he returned to the top of the stairs, he sat in his original spot and fiddled with the hem of his pajama leg.
"How is Miss Josie?"
Mama smiled wearily.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.